Satoru Kubo, famously known for his story Bleach, was approached in 2018 to make a manga for the 50th commemoration of Shonen Jump. Nakano, the chief and editor of Shueisha or Shonen Jump right now, gave Kubo two options: make a Bleach sequel or an entirely new manga one-shot that wouldn't progress any further. Kubo decided to do both and create Burn the Witch within the same universe as Bleach, leading 2 years after the events of the Thousand Year Blood War arc, creating not only a new series but one that introduced new and current fans. The concept and ideas stuck within his mind so much that he created what we would call now technically four chapters. He created this story after doing the one shot of his own free will and out of his own boredom, which, a long story short, Nakano had seen this and pushed Kubo to allow him to publish this within the magazine, and even going as far as to push a big movie from this series in and of itself. The sheer confidence put Burn the Witch on a pedestal, which gives us the fans this feeling of, is this series really worth the investment? Or is Nakano, the big cheese editor of Jump, just being a fan of his friend or his previous colleague that was an editor for Bleach 4 back in the day? Well, I think it's safe to say, after all the anticipation and marketing, the fanbase finally got to read what we would technically call the quote-unquote first chapter, and it continues on from the one-shot that we had previously read in 2018, so if you haven't gone and read that already, I would recommend doing so. The idea of this chapter is to first tell you more about the world and lead into what is going to be the ending concept, but is more importantly subject to its own characters. Without going too much on the one shot, I've already done videos of that in the past to show you how the economics of the world work, and I think Kubo really did that again just to do a reminder. He shows basically the dragons, what they're used for, tells you more about the good dragons and the bad dragons. It also gives you more about the economy, and I think in general really puts you into the scene of that whole atmosphere in general and the lifestyle of Reverse London. It also gives you nice little economic things, such as showing that whatever work you do in Reverse London you can transfer into the bank account into normal London, so clearly there is a connection between the two Londons which work in synergy. And what I mean by that is, if you can transfer money from the Reverse London into the normal London, then surely you have people from the organizations working on both sides of the spectrum to kind of manage that, and the government know all about it. So it's not a completely secret, it's just secret from civilians. So it really gives you that sense of government in a sense, which is a nice touch to say the least. And Kubo didn't really need to go that much in depth into the world, but he did, and it really plays its own part into making things make sense. But for the majority of the part, we start off with the chapter of Nee Mother Spangle being just adorable in her hoodie. We find out that she left the idol band that she was in previously, which is really unfortunate. It really is interesting to see where it will go with this, because we've seen from the PVs in general, we've seen that actually the anime is probably going to be animating the OVA, seeing as we have the billboard with Nini's promotion on there that got destroyed in the one shot. So it's possible that we are going to get the first 10 minutes of like the movie, then following up with the 10 minutes of being this chapter, is my prediction. But to not go off topic, basically she left the band. I wonder what happened. Was there a bit of drama? Unfortunately, we find out about this guy called TJ, and look, he ain't worth the time of day, right? He just ain't. But I guess for comedic purposes, I say that, I'm actually projecting really hard. Fuck TJ, right? Apparently, Nini broke up with TJ. Hopefully, she was the one that did the break. Of course, she was the one that did the breaking up. I can't imagine that they dated for long, because, of course, like, in an idol group, you can't really have a boyfriend, so that's probably why she left the idol band too. So this probably lasts for maybe like a week or so. So she's still pure, boys. It's canon, because I said it is, right? It's fucking canon. We have Nini. We express how the medallion, how Noelle got into Reverse London before in the one shot, how she used the red phone boxes that London is famous for, how she got there, has been used again by Nini, except for she used her phone this time and she just used it as a gateway. It seems it doesn't really matter how you really get there, as long as you conceal how you get there, which is the important factor. That seems to be a prevalent rule within this. I was also led to believe that Noelle was the only one that was chilling in London and just happened to have this as a part-time job, but it seems that everyone in Reverse London who works within the organization do work there back and forth. It seems that London is their main place to live. It would seem so. It is a bit of like an assumption at this moment, but we're going to go with that for the time being. It seems like Virgo, or Bargo, however you want to call him, is a bit of an issue in this case, but it's not that so much he can't control Asushi, which is the dog that was saved within the last chapter or the one shot. It seems to be that he's becoming a problem. We don't know why he's becoming a problem. Realistically, it seems that he's eluding a lot of black dragons or dark dragons, as you would call them. And there is the difference between, that's what this whole chapter was signifying, is that this is the difference. There is normal dragons, the one that create resources, the one that create help for the economy, and ones that help on the day-to-day basis within this world. And then there are dark dragons, one that resent humans, they use them for hunger, and those that have been laid dormant for quite a while, in a nutshell. And because it seems to me that Bargo is in this city, or in reverse London, it seems like he seems to elude or attract them a lot. And that is the question as to why specifically Virgo. I want to keep calling him Bargo, but there's Virgo too, so there's some weird translations, I will admit. So it doesn't really matter, just go with whatever you feel comfortable with. I don't think it really matters. But it seems like the organization behind the Burn the Witch, I guess, round table of governors, so to say, which is really interesting, because when I read the spoilers for this and I saw these characters, it was very interesting to me how Kubo is one of the only mangakas to do 4 chapters of a series, introduce this many characters, and be able to make a quick, concise chapter that feels fulfilling as well as enticing at the same time. There's a lot to talk about in such what would seem such a small amount of time, and that's what Kubo does best. He really lays on these characters, and especially the designs in general, the names. It really goes to show you a lot about their personality just from the designs as themselves, as well as the designs of the character names. But it seems like we have a really interesting cast of characters, and you have to question, does Kisuke know about of course he does. He was one of the only people that seemed to have mentioned it or acknowledged that there was a Western branch Soul Society. So of course he knows, and it would be nice to see if there is a reference in there from the research and development team over in Reverse London. That would be really interesting and funny to see as well. But it seems like Virgo is going to be the spotlight of this series, which is very interesting because, yes, the two main characters are the heroines, and I think that that's amazing. And Virgo was kind of just like thrown into this situation. So instead of making him the goofball that's kind of like the slave or like the responsibility of the two girls to look after, so he's not like executed, it seems like, he could have kept that gag going, like Kubo could have kept that gag going, but no, he's giving him relevancy. And we got three chapters to see how Virgo is going to progress through this story. And I think it's such a hit and miss that like Kubo's really got to do something really smart here. But overall, Virgo as a character, to be completely honest, even though he's a goofball and he's a bit of a simp towards Noelle, it works because of his demeanor. His demeanor is quite friendly, it's very carefree. He doesn't really care whether he gets with Noelle or not, like he's just doing him. And I think like that's the difference of why you can't really hate a character like that. Well, I mean, you can, obviously, but like it works with him because like it doesn't matter either way or all, because he's still a good character outside of the low-key pervy simping, as you would say. So the interactions with Noelle and him, the interactions with Nini and him are really great. They connect well. We get to understand about Nini's character a lot more, which is Nini is about merit rather than money, which is very interesting to me because I really want to understand what merit is going to be doing for her. She really wants to get into the Piper's Guild, which is something that one of her squadron leaders, actually we found out because he got promoted in the one shot, and then we find out that he actually got fired for doing no work within just a few days, so that's a bit of a par, it would seem. So she really wants to get into the Pipers, and she believes in strength over, well, I mean, Noelle's kind of like, we just got to do our job, and Nini wants, like, no, I want to prove, like, my worth, I want to prove my power. And that's interesting. What does the Pipers guild or squad have in comparison to the one she's in currently at the moment? So hopefully we get more backstory on that, we understand what the events are or the qualifications to do that are. I wonder how it's going to affect Nini now that like the government, or that's what I'm going to call it, the government are after Virgo, because she's the responsibility of Virgo. So what is she going to choose? Promotion? This is my take. I think there's going to be, Nini, you can have the promotion, but you got to hand over Virgo, or we fight you, basically. Or, like, you don't hand over Virgo and you never get the promotion. And I think that's going to be a choice that she's going to have to make. And I hope she protects Virgo, because obviously I think she has that pride. She is a human after all, in terms of that. She's not completely cold. But that's what we got for the majority of the chapter. We got to see some really cool spells, which is like the Kido equivalent. I've always said that Kido is kind of like spells in that regard. Maybe not in the magic sense, but maybe Ryatsu strength. So is this Reishi? Is it? We don't really know if it's Reishi yet. Is this something that is dormant within them? We understand that there is something, a new metric called the Drago something. Oh, brilliant review, James. It's called a Drago toxin, which I would assume, just like radiation, there's radiation everywhere in the world, and I think the body has a certain amount of radiation within their own bodies. Except in this world, there's something called a Drago toxin, and once it reaches a certain threshold, that's when you start to turn into a dragonclad, or classified as a dragonclad. So they have measurements to dictate whether how much Drago toxin you have, and of course, this was experimented with when a civilian within the Reverse London almost came into contact with Virgo's doggo, Osushi, and he almost came into contact with that. Thankfully, he didn't touch it, and he was able to get away with 0.03 Drago toxin meters, whatever you want to call it, millichromes or whatever it was called. So that was a really interesting mindset to go in. So if you have something like this in the world, is a Drago toxin essentially the Soul Society's equivalent to Reishi? And if so, that needs to be explained more. That's going to be really interesting to see how that works out in general, for world building purposes, and to also understand Bleach lore a little bit better as well, in terms of how the worlds and the parallels exist and coexist with each other. So I hope Kubo really delves more into this. I think this chapter did an amazing job with not only giving action, comedy, lovable moments, and also a lot of exposition as well. The point of the matter is that Kubo introduced the characters well. He introduced the world well. He gave brilliant world building and economics, telling us how the world works. Character designs, everything was on point. And at the end of the chapter, it gave you a sense of suspense of wanting more. You wanted to find out what was going to happen, and gave us a society within one chapter, and it absolutely hit to its degree. But if there's one thing that I have to, not have to, but if I had to try and find something to complain about, maybe, and it's an absolute reach, it would probably have to be understanding more. I wanted to get more of a solidification on how the world works and its powers. But I feel like we're going to get that more later on as the chapters go on. And maybe Virgo would need some character development in terms of, like, you know, the goofy guy cliche can be improved on. So I'm going to give it the benefit of the doubt. It's one chapter. So I'm going to catch you guys later. If you guys want to hear more about Burn the Witch, there's a Discord link in the description down below. Please follow me on Twitter for any Burn the Witch news. And of course, if you want to see more reviews and live reactions from me, there's also a Patreon. But more importantly, please like and subscribe. That would be amazing. With that being said, tell me why Nini's best girl. With that being said, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fun. I've been Hanson, and as always, people, peace out.